Hi, everybody. First of all, offer my condolences to everyone in history department. It's really hard to lose a colleague, but I also wanted to thank everyone for coming today. I didn't expect such a great turnout. Proof of the interest in Japanese American history or the very strength of this department, either one. I also want to thank the Nathan Jeanette Miller Center for Historical Studies and the University of Maryland Libraries for the generous support for this trip, which really is going to contribute greatly to my coverage of the occupation and the following years in my dissertation. And also, while I'm at it, also have to thank the Fulbright Japan Foundation and Association for Asian Studies, who's also supported my work over the last couple of years. More months than what they expected. As much as there's talk, as some of you may have heard, about a big gap between Asian studies and Asian American studies, my Asian studies comrades have always welcomed me with open arms and let me tell my story about Japanese Americans and events that largely take place in the U.S. under the guise of Japanese history. So my project bridges the gap between the two fields of Japanese history. And that interest, my interest in Japanese American, part of Japanese history, is kind of a reflection of my somewhat unorthodox educational background. When I first came to history as an undergrad, I was primarily interested in issues of race in American society, in large part because of my upbringing in rural Indiana, where a lot of the issues of race that have kind of come back into full force in American society were pretty prevalent. So during my coursework, I also found myself interested in Japan, in large part because Japan occupies this fairly complicated historical place in world society as both a genuine victim of racist exclusion and also a perpetrator of racist exclusion and violence. And then as I took courses related to that with Professor Ken Ruoff, my former advisor, I became more and more interested in following the path of Japanese history instead. So during my master's degree coursework at Portland State University, I took intensive Japanese courses to prepare for my PhD program. That left me with a little bit of a problem, though. I was technically working with a Japan specialist, but I really didn't speak Japanese or couldn't read Japanese very well at all. Luckily, my advisor suggested to me that I should do a local history, a history of the Japanese community in Portland, Oregon, where I was at the time. And so that culminated in a research project about the return of Japanese Americans to Portland, Oregon after World War II, and the trials and tribulations they faced in returning. But that project left me with one major question as I kind of stepped a little closer into the Japanese studies realm, and has driven my dissertation going forward. Namely, how did Japan's national image on the world stage changed so dramatically after World War II? And you can see it even in the documents from Japanese American communities, they say that things have changed a lot after World War II in terms of the social landscape of post-war America. So there's basically two major working explanations for this shift in the field of Japanese studies. First, John Dower, noted for his work on occupied Japan, argues that the flexible nature of American racialized images of Japan helped explain the shift from inhuman wartime enemy that you saw in U.S. propaganda during World War II to a kind of friendly and feminized junior ally that you also saw in American propaganda but following the war. Others, such as Yukiko Koshiro, really emphasize the importance of direct contact between occupied personnel and the Japanese public during the occupation, which helped produce a friendlier image of Japan in the minds of Americans. And both of these are true in their own way, but they kind of leave out something very important. So in describing the shift, both arguments really are kind of obsessed with American imagination, i.e. they're really kind of obsessed with just what's going on in Americans' minds. The only historical subjects that are important in these, in terms of producing a new vision of Japan, are white Americans. Japanese are just objects in this kind of discourse. So this creates a really problematic binary historiographic framework. And one solution, my solution to this, to complicate that binary framework, is to emphasize the role that elite groups of Japanese Americans have played a really strong role in restarting trade with the U.S. and in public diplomatic projects between the U.S. and Japan. This kind of group of Nisei traders and others, if you introduce their experience, you can get a little bit closer to what's actually happening in the United States. You get a little closer to the physical spaces where Americans encountered Japanese culture for the first time after World War II. And certainly, you know, hundreds of thousands of American troops encountered Japanese culture directly during the occupation, but a much larger group encountered Japanese Americans as their way of learning about Japanese culture. I'll say though that I'm not the first person to put Japanese Americans as kind of Japanese history framework as important actors in Japanese history. And most of the other people that do this are kind of relying on empire studies. So the biggest work in empire studies in Japan, Japanese history, is Louise Young's Japan's Total Empire. And her intercession is to say that the formation of empire and the social structures of empire really had a formative impact on the modernization of Japan during the 20s and 30s. That what happened in the colonies had a very direct impact on Japanese history itself. Using that framework, people like my advisor, Eiichiro Azuma, and then some younger generation of scholars, including Sidney Chu Liu and Emily Anderson and a few others, have used that idea that Japanese Americans, by participating in imperialism or by telling the true story of Japan, as it were, in the 1930s, defending Japanese actions in Manchuria, in that way they were able to play an important role in Japanese history. My intercession is to take that story of Japanese Americans participating very fully in Japanese history and move it into the post-war period and look again, as I said, at this reshaping of American ideas of Japan. And an historical framework that I use is something that's still kind of emerging for people who do Asian studies. We call it the Pacific World paradigm. It's very much explicitly modeled on the Atlantic world, which is famous for studies of the slave trade. So it's kind of a transnational approach where you take certain kind of social phenomenon that would play a bit part in, say, the history of Britain or in Northern African histories, and then tell that as a larger story. And I really focus on the mobility of goods, ideas, people, and how it formed a kind of transnational civil society across the Pacific, in which we see, I try to place all these actors in. I talk about this between basically the 1880s and the 1960s, but as you mentioned, I'm gonna give a kind of condensed version, focused a little bit more on the occupation period. So in doing our research, I've kind of had two major goals, research here and research elsewhere. The first is to trace these transnational social networks and the ways in which the people in them represented Japan to the American public. So to take a specific example, you can look at the family of someone called Togasaki Kikumatsu, who is a Japanese-American trader and isei from San Francisco. And he started a company called the Mutual Supply Company. And he was an importer of Japanese food and Japanese art goods. And in his role as a prominent merchant, he also was a board member of the Japanese Chamber of Commerce in San Francisco, which by the 1930s was really the primary, most powerful social organizations for Japanese-Americans in the Bay Area. The Chamber Board was also made up of heads of large Japanese monopoly corporations, and as such had really strong ties to the Japanese business world and the foreign ministry, so it should come as no surprise that during the 1930s, the San Francisco Japanese Chamber of Commerce played a really important role in propagating Japanese propaganda about their role in Manchuria, defending Japanese imperial actions. His sons, Kiyoshi and Susumu also went on to represent Japan in various ways. Kiyoshi, like many Misei, second generation Japanese, for those who aren't familiar with parlance, moved to Japan for college in the 1930s, and because of the vagaries of immigration law, his wife, who he met in Japan, wasn't able to gain residency in the U.S., so he stayed in Japan, and ended up becoming a representative of Standard Oil in Japan, and then later a managing editor for the Japan Times and the Nippon Times, I forget when they changed the name, and eventually became the president of Rotary International, which is kind of a civic organization that promotes commerce and goodwill. During 1968, he represented Japan in that capacity. His brother Susumu, also known as Sim Togasaki, went on to play a key role in the Japanese American Citizens League, the national chapter, the national board, I should say. And the Japanese American Citizens League is a still prominent national civil rights organization. And he also helped to reestablish the Bank of Tokyo in post-war California, amongst a number of other Japan-related business projects. In telling these stories, my point, though, is not to collect a series of interesting biographies, though, but to really to reveal the social institutions that tied the Japanese and Japanese-American communities to Japanese business and diplomatic circles, as both avenues for influence for Japanese-Americans to increase their business, but also for the reverse, for Japanese diplomats looking to coordinate events, et cetera, et cetera. And so I guess this brings me to my, before I move on to the second goal, I have this fairly complicated diagram, which some of you may not be able to see. But basically, my idea is to present this in a transnational framework, Japanese and the United States separated completely and talking to each other across the Pacific, but instead as connected in terms of public diplomacy at various levels. So at the official level, you see the Prime Minister, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, working directly with the United States. That's what we call formal diplomacy. And then below that, you have kind of social institutions, the Tokyo Chamber of Commerce, the Japanese Immigration Society, a bunch of others, work with intermediaries in the Japanese-American communities, particularly the Japanese Chambers of Commerce in New York, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and Honolulu, and Japanese associations, which by the 1930s were basically the same. And they try to cultivate contacts within the white business community, but also connect to a series of other social institutions, which I won't go through explaining all of them. So that kind of brings me to my second goal, though. In looking at the way Japan's image changed following the war, especially, but also a little bit during the 1930s, I try to connect that change to physical places where it actually happened, where Americans encountered Japanese culture and created impressions of it for the first time. Particularly talking about Japanese restaurants in post-war America, where sukiyaki, kind of a Japanese hot pot dish, is very popular. Trade fairs and public festivals such as the Nisei Week, which still goes on every year in Los Angeles. In the earlier parts of my dissertation, I focus on the establishment of two types of retail stores, a series. The first is a kind of national network of general stores which catered to labor immigrants, and another which sold art goods to white, usually upper-class collectors. These are very important places for formation of ideas about Japan, basically from the 1870s until World War II, and really kind of after it as well. But these stores were also outlets for products associated with Japanese culture, and they were particularly useful for Japanese corporations trying to enter the American market. And I also say that though it plays a kind of side, a bit part in my dissertation's narrative, World's Fairs also play a really important role in shaping American understandings of Japan, partially just because of the volume of people that saw these exhibits. Japan exhibits, basically from the first World's Fair in 1876 in Philadelphia, was one of the most popular exhibits at all the World's Fairs. And, you know, millions of people went to the one in 1939 in New York, before New York as well. So the part that fascinates me about the occupation era is in terms of this interchange in physical spaces in the United States, is that you get to see how these social spaces have to be rebuilt after the kind of wartime anti-Japanese hysteria, and how at the same time commodity networks, the sale of soy sauce and other kind of products, get rebuilt at the same time. During the occupation, the Japanese foreign ministry really wanted to restart trade with the U.S. Of course, the general headquarters, the American occupation government, also really did too. And so the first kind of institutions of for trade promotion were what were called the Japanese overseas agencies. They were basically consulates. And they had two jobs. One was to promote Japanese products, and the other was to work with Japanese Americans who were having financial issues related to their assets in Japan or these sorts of things. When trade resumed, public trade, as opposed to state-mediated trade between U.S. and Japan, when private trade was resumed in 1947, we had a serious issue. And I apologize for those of you who can't read Japanese, but as you had in America, Japanese overseas agencies working directly with Japanese Americans, the occupation government still basically controlled everything. So at the top level, you have the kind of occupation government. And below that, you have a Japanese agency called the Trade Ministry. And then below that, several kind of what they call public corporations in charge of various forms of trade in Japan. There was one for the food trade, for instance. And all these arrows back and forth are forms that you had to file with various different agencies before you could make a single trade. If you wanted to sell a cask of soy sauce in the United States, you had to go through all of this paperwork. This is made more complicated by the fact that Japanese business circles were constantly looking to revise these, so the procedures changed quite often. And I won't get into the details, I'm just suffice it to say that it was complicated, and doing business in post-war Japan was not an easy task. This served a really important purpose, though. Post-war Japan had a really serious problem. Their problem was they didn't have enough food, so they had to import a lot of food from the United States. That meant spending all of their currency reserves on American products, in addition to aid, et cetera, et cetera. And so this system was designed to help allot that currency to specific corporations that could trade with the U.S. to gain that currency back from the United States. Raw material allotments work in the same way. But basically my point of saying this is if you had particular connections in the U.S., your corporation was going to do a lot better. So at the same time, you see two groups of Japanese Americans, second generation Japanese Americans in Japan working for the occupation army, and a bunch of former importers whose businesses were uprooted by their wartime incarceration, and a lot of times they lost all their assets. They're really looking to start trade with Japan to rebuild their livelihoods. Many of these traders in the United States, often first-generation Japanese Americans, such as Pacific Trading Company's Sugihara Gunzo, he and others had the sons in Japan working for the occupation army or working for various Japanese corporations. And they were in a kind of particularly good position to restart trade with Japan, having kind of ally on the ground, as it were. So then afterwards, these Japanese American businesses became a platform for companies to re-enter the American market. Again, to take the Sugihara example, this company, Pacific Trading Company, was the first to import Kikkoman soy sauce after World War II, and then after the occupation, built a nationwide sales network for Kikkoman soy sauce amongst both Japanese Americans restaurants and the white public in California, especially. And was later acquired and is now Kikkoman International, which you can see a group of Japanese Americans who I forget which ones who we are at this point, but which is still the American arm of Kikkoman Corporation from Japan. So over the course of the occupation, you start to see Japanese diplomats and corporate officials reaching out to people like this, these Nisei intermediaries in Japan, and often provide families who own trading companies back in the US, in order to kind of rebrand their products to the American market. And diplomats especially were interested in having Nisei represent them in public events, such as trade fairs. Basically, the Nisei woman in kimono became the kind of standard bearer for Japanese public diplomacy projects after this. So here at the Prange collection, I found a large number of documents that cast new light on kind of three elements. First, the process of rebuilding trade with the U.S. itself, and this complicated graph is from the Japan Trade News. Also, the actors in Japan who were most closely connected to Japanese-American communities, and how the two groups cooperated with each other, Japanese-Americans and Japanese officials. So one of the most useful magazines in the collection for this purpose was the Japan Trade Museum News. The Japan Trade Museum was a revival of a pre-war system of Japanese commercial museums. It spanned the whole empire, and there were many of them in the U.S. as well, which worked for worked to promote Japanese products to the American public, but also served as a conduit for information on trade. Following the war, there was a number of Japanese-American traders who were interested in redeveloping that conduit of information and sent letters to the Japan Trade Museum, which is, again, I'm sorry for those, even those who could read Japanese probably can't read this. pictures are important, I guess. But this is an article from 1948, which is a series of letters from Japanese American traders from San Francisco, New York, and elsewhere, which offered advice to the museum about what white Americans found interesting. So decorations, which is lamps, kimono, things that represented Japanese culture were all of a sudden becoming very popular, especially amongst the spouses of former occupation personnel. And this section has another letter from San Francisco in which the writer argues that the best way to overcome lingering racism and negative perceptions of Japanese products is to sell them in Chinese-owned stores in San Francisco. which they've been doing for a long time before the war, too. And there's many of these letters published in this particular magazine, but all of them express this explicit solidarity with Japan, having read in the news about Japan's post-war destruction after the war, because they felt a kind of affinity. Because they were turned, they were uprooted from their lives, as you see the term often and again and again. They felt a real solidarity and wanted to help Japan in a number of ways. I also discovered that the head of the foreign section of the Japan Trade Museum was actually the head of the San Francisco Trade Museum before the war. So as you can imagine, there was very close ties between this newly reestablished institution in Japan and people in San Francisco. And that leads me to, I won't go on about all these publications, but another one which is particularly useful for Japanese American history, there are two sister publications which reveal a kind of network of journalists in Japan with deep connections in the Japanese American community. First is the Nichibei Gaido, which was a Japanese American guide, I guess you would say. Another one's called Nichibei Kinema, or Japanese American Cinema, which carried regular articles on happenings among Nisei in Japan and back in the US. Nichibei Kinema was started as a promotional magazine, and here you can see its founder, Kumamoto Toshinori, for his company, which imported Japanese films to the United States, mainly for consumption by Japanese Americans, but also by the larger American public. And he's, I'd really like to try and get a picture of the original at some point. We can talk about that. But this Nichibei Kinema magazine would often be full of scenes from Japanese movies, as you can kind of tell. It's very useful for Japanese Americans who had an interest in Japanese culture still and wanted to follow the movies that are coming out. But interspersed, there would be English sections for those that couldn't read Japanese, and there would be articles about the happenings of Nisei and Tokyo Times. And then the Nichibei Gaido was a publication edited by Ozawa Takeo, who has an interesting place in Japanese American history as the person who filed a brief he filed a lawsuit against the U.S. government in 1922, claiming U.S. citizenship on the grounds that he was a white American. Was rejected, and this became one of the main pretexts in which Japanese Americans were deprived of their civil rights in the pre-war period. Afterwards, I'm not sure the details, he returned to Japan and eventually became the editor of this magazine. And one of the other major contributors to this magazine is a man named Shiba Sometaro. And you don't need to remember his name exactly, but he has an interesting position as well, and he represents this kind of like group of journalists that moved to the U.S. to work in Japanese American newspapers, or own Japanese American newspapers. He started several in Hawaii before he moved back to Japan in 1917 and bought the Japan Times. So it should come as no surprise, the Japan Times, which is still one of the leading English language dailies in Japan, hired a lot of Japanese Americans during the 30s and later during the occupation. And those of you who can read Japanese might notice that there's an interestingly named committee that this particular article is talking about. And it gets to the kind of the final dynamic I want to talk about, an interesting story within this kind of trans-Pacific social network. It has to do with the giving and receiving of imoni, or care goods, comfort goods. In the 1930s, a lot of Japanese Americans were interested in supporting people on the front lines in Manchuria, particularly Issei, first generation Japanese Americans. And so they would send what were called imomukuro, or comfort bags, to people on the front lines in Manchuria. This really touched the Japanese people, and when they heard in 1942 about what had happened to Japanese Americans being interned en masse, they formed a committee called the Committee to Aid Overseas Brethren, made up of a lot of these journalists and people from immigration societies in Japan. And they raised $3 million yen from people on the street during wartime Japan, and then sent a large amount of goods, mostly food, to the United States and elsewhere on Red Cross ships in 1943. This really touched the hearts of Japanese Americans in internment camps. And so after World War II, seeing the devastation, and this is an article from 1946 in a Japanese American newspaper from New York, seeing this devastation, they were really touched and started fundraising campaigns in the United States, again, to send more comfort goods to Japan. And so in forming the communities to raise the money for these comfort goods, they reestablished community organizations, especially amongst Japanese-speaking Japanese Americans. So on this map, you can see all the major kind of care organizations, the committees to kind of form to send Japan relief. And then the money and goods that they collected were sent to Japan under a special American government program called the License Agencies for Relief in Asia, which sent, hundreds of thousands of pounds of goods to Japan. But alongside of this, you see all over the Western Hemisphere, and also in Shanghai and elsewhere, and buy goods in the United States, later buy goods in Japan, and then send them to families in rural Japan, especially. And so the point for my larger argument is, how does this affect Japan's image in the United States? It seems unrelated, but it ends up being very much connected. So in order to raise this money, Japanese American groups all over the United States have a lot of culture nights, Japan nights, movie nights, these kind of things. And this becomes an important point in which Japanese American communities can reconnect, but also becomes a very important place where the broader white American community can learn about Japanese culture. And it starts a trend, I guess you said restarts a trend, of cultural performance in public events and public festivals that really starts to gain the interest of the white American public. And I think that these performances and the consumption of Japanese food in Japanese restaurants and seeing Japan-related exhibits at world fairs really have an important effect on American perceptions of Japan, particularly a new vision of Japan not as an enemy, but as a nation with a rich traditional culture. Some of the ideas about Japan's traditional culture were fairly contrived at this point. But also as a nation that is working its hardest to modernize and kind of follow the American example. So by way of conclusion, I'd just like to clarify exactly what it is when I call all of these dynamics that I've been talking about across the Pacific, when I call them grassroots public diplomacy. Because when you think of public diplomacy, you often think of